Good evening, I'm Jim Goodale, and you are watching The Digital Age. Got a great show for you tonight. Have you been watching digital radio? Watching, listening to digital radio? I listen to it all the time. I'll never go back to the old time radio. It's fabulous. And tonight's program is going to be about that. And here to tell us all about it is Mel Karmazin, who is president of and CEO of Sirius Radio. The question tonight, Mel, is Sirius, Sirius. But let me tell the audience, if they need to know, a little bit about you. The Horatio Alger of the media business. Started at
the luckiest guy in the media business.
Anyway, started at WNEW, right?
Well, I started an advertising agency before that, and went to work at CBS from this advertising agency, and then had an opportunity to spend a great 11 years with John Kluge at Metromedia, which included running WNEW, right, which at that time was a legendary AM radio, right, station with Klavan and Finch and William, right, B. Williams and Ted Brown. And then I ran NEW-FM. And then two of my partners, who became partners, started a company called Infinity Broadcasting. And Infinity Broadcasting owned three radio stations in 1980. And I joined the company in November of 1981, and we acquired an FM station in New York, an AM station in New York, and an FM in Philadelphia. The FM station here in New York was WKTU, and is now K-Rock.
Remember, WKTU was really the
Disco
hottest.
Disco 92.
Then Infinity became pretty much the largest radio company in the United States. Then it really took over CBS, though we didn't know it was taking over CBS. It really merged, merger of equals or whatever. You ended up CEO there. Then all of a sudden, the whole McGiller, as they say in New York, ended up at Viacom, and you became the chief operating officer of Viacom. I mean, it's an amazing story. But now, this story is better, as far as I'm concerned. All the Mel Karmazin stories, because I'm so hooked on digital radio. I love the idea of you going to Sirius. What is it? What do you call it?
Sirius Satellite Radio.
Sirius Satellite Radio. And I tell you, my first question is, I want to get it. But how do I get it?
Okay, so maybe let me give you some background. I'll start from the beginning. Where do you get it? The answer is there's 25,000 stores throughout America that sell radio. You buy your Sirius Satellite Radio, Best Buy, Circuit City, Radio Shack. You call the phone number that's on the...
Okay, let me just tell you, but that means I can, because I think of this as a car radio, so I can get it at home?
Absolutely.
25,000 stores, I can get it at home.
Yeah. You can go to any Best Buy store and pick up a satellite radio. And what's happened in the radio business, the radio business started in 1926. And, you know, it was AM radio. And then in the 60s, FM radio became the dominant medium of listening. And now it's evolving into satellite radio. And satellite radio offers customers the opportunity to hear 120 channels. So if you are a country music fan in New York City and terrestrial radio may not offer you the opportunity to have a country station, we have six country music stations. If you like big band music, if you like that WNEW sound, that's not available to you in New York. You can get that on satellite radio. So the compelling argument for it is that, you know, there was AM, it's now FM, and now the new generation is satellite radio.
And satellite radio is digital, and we are talking about the digital age. Now, let me just tell you my own experience. I get my digital radio from the computer. And a couple of years ago, because I want to be on the vanguard, a little late because people have been getting radio before 2 years ago, I found it was tough to get it, so I sort of gave up. Then I went into my AL a couple of months ago, and there was a radio button. I'll tell you, that radio button is on, and it's never off anymore. I don't listen to the regular radio because I can get the radio station I want, which is WQXR in New York, but also I get this huge, huge variety of choices. Now, let me ask you on satellite radio. You know, I've got the variety that I talked about on the computer. And we know if we've got, let's say, cable, radio, we've got a variety. Those program mixes, you know, are somewhat the same. Do you, how does, there's one guy up in upstairs who does it for everybody, how does that do?
So I think this digital world has made the experience for the consumer terrific. There's so many more choices for the American public to have, and that's great. But all the things that you're talking about are principally in home today. Great. So, and most of the people are listening to radio out of the home.
Yeah, I was going to say.
So we have, the typical experience is that over 80% of people in New York City will listen to radio away from their home, particularly in the car. And though I'm sure it will come one day, the bandwidth will be wide enough to be able to have, you know, internet radio come into your car, but that's not there today. So if you want radio in your car today, you either get your AM/FM radio or your satellite radio. If you choose to listen to satellite radio, I saw some research yesterday that 83% of your time listening to the radio, so if you have an AM/FM right, satellite radio, 83% of your time is spent listening to the satellite radio. And the reason for it is,
wait a minute, say, if you got a choice, you spend
83% of your time listening to the satellite portion.
I know you're about to make a conclusive point here, but I just wanted to get clear in my head. Does that mean that the car person, the driver, we call him, right? The driver is has got a choice. In other words, if I get satellite in my car, do I have a choice between hitting the satellite and hitting the regular radio?
Okay, so if you go to Mercedes and you buy a brand new Mercedes, or you buy a brand new Ford product or a brand new Chrysler product, and you order Sirius satellite radio, factory installed, the way it would look is you'd have on your dashboard a radio, and there would be a button that says AM, a button that says FM, and a button that says satellite. If you go to the Best Buy and you buy one of our plug-and-play products, you take this product, you can listen to it at home, or you can put it into your car, and you can hear it in your car, satellite radio, and still have the ability to listen to AM/FM. The point is that why would you want to continue to listen to the traditional radio when you have the choice?
And one of the sound, but the thing we haven't talked about, I'm sorry to keep interrupting, but one thing to talk about is the sound is so fabulous when it's digital. So you were talking about if you wanted to go back and forth, you wouldn't, and then I interrupted you, but I'm saying to myself, I don't want to hear AM, FM anymore, but go ahead.
Yeah, it's CD quality. So just like FM was an improvement from AM, satellite radio is an improvement. But still, you know, some people might want to hear their local news.
Yeah, I was going to say.
They still might want to hear some special content.
They want to hear the traffic.
They want to hear traffic. Again, one of the features that Sirius Satellite Radio offers is we offer traffic information
in
20 markets.
I can't believe it. It seemed to me that was sort of like the great fallacy in the thing. But, you know, the programming, you're such a modest guy. It's hard to get out of you. This programming you've got, I mean, the way I would have answered the other question about AOL, your programming, frankly, is a lot better.
Well, I think
Howard Stern
is king.
We can't talk about this without talking about Howard Stern.
I think content is king. I think that people don't just watch television. You know, they watch shows on television. And we are a big believer on what is going to drive satellite radio is going to be our content. So we have made a deal with the NFL. So if you're living in New York City, you're able to listen to the Jet game on radio, or you're able to listen to the Giant game. If you're a subscriber to Sirius, you'll be able to listen to every single football game that's on Sunday. Every single game. We have the bandwidth to be able to have every game.
So it's like digital cable, where you can subscribe to the series.
Well, it's sort of, if you think about the Sunday ticket that's on DirecTV, we also give you the ability, so let's assume you're listening to radio and you want to hear the Pittsburgh-New England game last weekend.
Right.
We'll give the customer the choice of hearing the local announcers from Boston, New England Patriots, or the announcers from Pittsburgh, because we have it on all of these different channels, because we have these 120 channels. The one point that we haven't mentioned, which I think in, you know, fairness we should.
120 channels, that's a lot of radio.
120 channels, is that you pay for it. Okay, so, I mean, you know, what's the gimmick?
You have to pay for it.
But it's $12.95 a month is what you wind up paying for it. So the argument is, well, gee, I can get free radio, or I can get satellite radio and pay for it. like television, you can still get your channel 247 and your programming over the air, or you can choose to pay for, you know, cable television, or you can afford, you know, you choose right. to pay for satellite television.
But now let me ask you something. This is the sort of question I get about Mel Karmazin, because as you started telling about your career and your reputation before you became a CEO and ran all these great companies, I mean, you were the greatest advertising salesman of all time. Now, you seem to be climbing a new mountain, the greatest subscription salesman of all time. Is there going to be advertising on this or not?
Well, there is already. So if you take our 120 channels, 65 of them are music. We don't want to put advertising on those music channels. A typical radio station will have anywhere from 25% of its time devoted to commercials to 30%. So there'll be, of the 60 minutes an hour, there might be 15 minutes of commercial time. So if you're listening to a music station in New York, you'll have 25% be commercials. If you're listening to satellite radio, you won't get any commercials on our music channels. So not only do we offer more choices, we offer them commercial free. And let me give you a compelling argument. In New York City, I had the benefit of having it be part of my company, WCBS-FM. It's an oldies radio station.
Yeah, oldies.
Music of the 60s, 70s, 80s,
90s. By the way,
90s.
You can get WCBS on AOL, for example.
Great. Yeah. So if you are an oldies fan, if you're a 60s music, you have to listen to the 70s music and the 80s music on that same channel. Yeah. If you're a subscriber to Sirius Satellite Radio, we have a 50s channel that only 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, plays 50s music. We have a 60s channel. We have a 70 that's part of this 120 channels. And you don't have to have commercials there. On the other channels that we offer, many of our talk channels, many of our channels that are, again, away from music, we will run commercials. And you mentioned Howard Stern, and the company announced that Howard will no longer be on terrestrial radio starting in January of 2006.
Terrestrial radio, what do you mean by that?
Terrestrial radio is the AM and FM model.
I noticed that when I read the newspaper, in fact, I want to talk about Michael Powell at the end of the show, but Michael Powell regulates terrestrial radio. I mean, what the hell is terrestrial radio?
Yeah.
I mean, it's radio, right? But anyway, go ahead.
It's radio that uses transmitters, you know, as compared to satellites.
Yeah, right.
So that would really be the difference. But the idea is that Howard will now be only on satellite radio.
And what's the date of that?
And that'll be January 6th. January of 2006. We don't have the exact date.
January 2006, that's pretty soon.
It's coming soon.
Okay, now that's a big story for Mel Karmazin. Isn't it? Because is it fair to say one of the events that catapulted Infinity, which is one of the companies you talked about, to fame, and that in turn catapulted everybody into Viacom, including the company, was Howard Stern? I mean, he was an...
Howard was a...
A big part of that.
Probably the most listened to, most successful radio personality of the last decade, you know, and a half. And when Howard was let go by GE, by NBC, Infinity hired him, in essence, the next day, and was the beneficiary of Howard being part of the company, as Don Imus was part of the company. But Howard was the single most significant personality in radio. Prior to my getting to Sirius, they made an arrangement for him to leave terrestrial radio, come to satellite radio, Sirius exclusively, so that...
You didn't make that deal?
I did not.
Was that part of the reason for you going?
Yes. I will tell you that I took notice. Mm-hmm. In other words, there were two things...
Sirius is sitting around there, and people are just beginning to pay attention to it now, I think.
There were two things that convinced me that this was going to be a big, big, big business. Okay, not just a, you know, a small company. And that was the decision to take the NFL. And it showed that the bandwidth, something that radio could not deal with.
Bandwidth, you mean the extra capacity that's there for
these 120 stations. Yeah. So if you think about it for a second, a radio station can have one game on at a time.
Yeah.
How can they... You know, let me see. You know, it must be the people from radio calling me. But how could they compete when satellite radio has the opportunity to have all the games on? So it showed its benefit over regular radio because it could do technologically things that regular radio couldn't do. And then the next thing that made me take notice was they hired Howard. And it's all about the content, and people absolutely listen to the radio, or as I said earlier, watch television because of the content, and it doesn't get any bigger than Howard. And we also have the NBA, and we also have the NHL if they ever played, you know, again. And we have soccer, you know, from the UK. No one here on, if you're a fan, if you're a fan of soccer and you want to,
you could have also in many sports. Well, you've got a limit of so many channels, but
120.
Geez.
You know, so that
so you
yeah,
could do we, all sorts of different sports. You could all,
and not only can we do sports, but let me give you something. We announced with Microsoft out at the Consumer Electronics Show. Consumers, when they're driving in their SUV or they're driving in their car with their kids, they like the idea of having the DVD player in that rear seat of the car. Our technology that exists today, not that will exist, exists today, we can give you live video to the rear seat of the car. So we've announced that starting in 06, we will have a number of channels aimed at kids, of course. There'll be a kids channel, maybe like, you know, Disney
a
or Nickelodeon,
channel.
That you'll be able to watch in live television. And the quality of that television, because of our technology, will be as good as the quality of your satellite or your cable at home.
So, that's coming from the same satellite?
Uh-huh.
Or is it a different beam?
No, it's coming from
the same
satellite.
Same beam, and it splits into radio and TV?
It's digits.
So to speak.
We're just
digits,
delivering digits into
digital,
the car.
Digital
you know?
Age will provide TV in your backseat for your
kids. Now let me give you another
thing. So you're in the TV and radio
in the car.
But
now,
you could do anything you wanted.
Well,
so you're going to have to program that. You're going to be in the programming business.
Well, we're in the programming business.
No, but I know you're, but for photos.
For television. Yeah. Something else we do. So you have a navigation system in your car.
Yeah.
We have the ability of hooking in live, real-time traffic information into your navigation system.
Yeah, I wanted to ask about that.
So that not just if you're driving, you know, up from New York City to Boston, we'll give you, your navigational system will tell you how to get there, but we'll tell you what the traffic is like on those roads.
How do you do that?
We have a company that we work with called Navitech, and Navitech has sensors in the roads, and the sensors in the roads feed.
The sensors must be digital, right?
And the sensors are digital. And what happens is they have the ability of aggregating in real time this traffic information, feed it to us, to the satellite, and we can feed it to you, to your car.
Well, that's extraordinary. Let's talk about some of the broader implications of this. Let's go back to Howard Stern, okay? Michael Powell recently, we always say recently in this program because we never know when we're going to rerun the program, announced that he was going to leave the FCC. Now, I don't know how much you want to talk about Michael Powell. If you tell me you don't want to talk about me, that's okay, but it seems to me you're not at CBS anymore, and you might be able to.
I would talk to you about Michael Powell if I was at CBS. I think it's a loss.
You think it's a loss?
To the country. I think that Michael Powell was a terrific, terrific chairman of the FCC. He had difficulties in getting his agenda across, you know, with Congress, and there were all the political things. He was smart, he was hardworking, he had a great vision, and I think that Michael Powell, as much as I had differences with him in a lot of areas, I thought that he was
good.
A great chairman.
Really? Well, here's the paradox with him as far as I can see.
And by the way, if Howard Stern is watching, you know, because Howard has a totally different viewpoint. You know, this is America, and I'm entitled to my point of view as well.
Well, the thing about Michael Powell, sort of a inconsistency, he's much in favor of deregulation. And many of his battles that are in our eye as media people were frankly out of the eye of the public, what he did with telephone and all that sort of stuff. But of course, indecency, which is very much in the public's eye, was regulation. So here he was, a deregulator, and then he regulated indecency in a way that I think even middle of the roaders can't understand. Do you want to comment on that
sure.
at all?
I think Michael was dragged into that battle. You know, I don't believe that that was an agenda item that he had. The FCC reports into Congress. Congress provides the funding to the FCC. And this was an issue that Congress had that was pressuring, in my opinion, the FCC to act on. This was not a Mike, you know, this goes back to, you know, when Al Sykes was the chairman of the FCC. This was something that every FCC commissioner had to do. I think there are so many things going on in this telecommunications world, and it, you know, that the FCC needs to be involved in, and for them to be the content police, you know, is a terrible waste of taxpayer money and a terrible waste of their resources.
Well, so what you're telling basically, you think it was a political pressure that was worked upon Michael to force him to take up this issue. Couldn't he have just resisted that? I mean, did he have the? Was there a problem in the commission? I mean, the pressure, it was three Republicans. Were the other Republicans? I guess the two Republicans were pushing for it. He's a Republican, and he's switching sides. So he's sort of forced in a position where he had to do something.
Well, you had, so it wasn't quite Democratic and Republican, because there was a time when the Democrats on the FCC were the more liberal people who would be, you know, who would be champions of free speech. This recent commission, that wasn't the case. As a matter of fact, the two Democrats who are on the FCC and remain on the FCC have been very aggressive on the subject of indecency. You also had the very right wing of the Republican Party, you know, religious people who were very concerned as well. So I think all of this got into a perfect storm that Congress wanted to do it. Yeah. The Democrats were no longer looking at this thing as, you know, First Amendment, you know, and the commission found itself in a position of regulating it. I can tell you, as a broadcaster for an awful lot of years, I never had an interest. There was never a business model. There was never a reason to want to air indecency. We totally believe and have believed from the very beginning that nothing that Howard Stern has ever done, rises to the level of indecency. You may not like it, it may be offensive, it may be obnoxious, but it's not indecent by the definition of indecency. I can also—
Which is a very vague, definition, and probably will be attacked in some massive lawsuit, I would suspect.
I can tell you that one of the most visible aspects of my position at Viacom was last year at the Super Bowl.
I was going to say, is visible the word you want to use in your mail?
So I got a call in the box that I was at after halftime that told us what went on. We conducted an unbelievable report. We hired an outside law firm to take a look at whether or not there was anybody within the organization that had any knowledge of what Justin Timberlake or Janet Jackson was going to do. And the answer to that was absolutely not. I also have watched that wardrobe malfunction more times than any American has ever watched it in slow motion. It was, in my opinion, it shouldn't have happened. I apologize that it happened under my watch. I was embarrassed that it happened under my watch. But this was something that Janet Jackson cooked up on her own and duped MTV, who was producing it, duped CBS, who was carrying it. That CBS should not be faulted for anything it did wrong.
What were we supposed to do? My position is that I wouldn't, you won't agree with this, I wouldn't even fault Janet Jackson. I mean, I'd fault her, but I don't see why she should have legal action against it. It was such a fleeting moment, it seems hard to me that you can actually penalize it.
I fault Janet Jackson for doing it in that venue particularly. Here was the Super Bowl. This is not her show. Yeah. This is, you know, all of America is watching. Lots of people, kids are watching it. That who is she to decide that she should go away from the script and do something that nobody had approved? So that was my problem. Was it something that should be fined? Absolutely not. You know, should it have happened? No, I didn't want it to happen, but it happened. And I don't believe that any broadcaster, you know, I mean, I just saw where the commission ruled that Private Ryan, you know, some complaints is not indecent. So let me get this straight. The commission is saying it's okay to say the F word in a drama, but it's not okay to say the F word in comedy? I looked at the Constitution. I can't find that.
The commission's got a tough position. Let's, we're coming to a close here, but I want to get your view. I don't see how old-fashioned, we now call it terrestrial radio, is going to make it. Well, you guys got everything. You got the sound. You got more programming. You think what's going to happen?
I think it's a very mature business. The newspaper business, it's been around for a long time. Terrestrial radio will be around for a long time. There's about $20 billion of advertising that's there. But you're going to see satellite radio showing extraordinary growth. Just like today, you have your local television station, and there's obviously a market for a local radio station, but an awful lot of people are watching these networks and are watching MTV and are watching ESPN and are watching these national networks. And we'll have the ability to put on all of this programming on a national level.
Of course, the big deal for you guys is in the car, but at home, I don't want a radio. What do I want a radio?
Let me play devil's advocate we would have difficulty.
Yeah.
Okay? You have to pay for it.
That's right. I have to pay for it. Let me ask you, we've really come almost to the very end. How many subscribers do you need? You got 1 million. In order for Sirius to be Sirius, how many do you have to make?
Okay, so we have about 1.2 million now today. We announced that we'll have 2.5 million by the end of the year. The analysts forecast that number will double in 2006, and in 2007, that number will be somewhere around 7 or 8 million subscribers, and that's the year that you start to make money.
And 7 million.
There are 90 million subscribers paying money for satellite television and cable television. There's no reason radio should not be at least as big, because there's 200 million cars on top of that.
We have to finish now. I'm sorry.
Good to see you.
But I want to ask you a question. Is Sirius serious, Mel Karmazin? Yes or no?
Very serious.
Thank you, Mel Karmazin, for coming by.
Good to see you.
And thank you for coming by, and come by next week to learn more about the digital age. For the digital age, I am Jim Goodale. Good night.